For chapter two is we look at the different monetary systems in place for international trades, right? So the key question here that we talk about is, if I want to go overseas to buy goods and services, how do I determine the value of the foreign currency, right? So if I want to buy goods and services from China, how much do I pay for one Chinese yuan, right? So in the past, people have different systems in place for different currency and regimes. These coincided with the different developments in the political world as well as the wars, right? So a lot of these systems were determined based on the political power at that time. So before 1875, we have a bimetallism system. This is a very basic system where we have two different metals and we issue coins based on the two different metals, right? From 1875 to 1914, so this was before the World War I, we have the classical gold standards where currency's values are determined by the value of the gold reserves of a certain country, right? Then the war broke out and things started to collapse because people started to disobey the rules. Then after the war, we need a new system which came out from the Bretton Woods meeting. So in the new system, besides gold, we also use the USD as the base currency, right, to calculate the values of the other currencies. Then after that, we decided to not fix the value of the currency anymore. We decided to have the market determine the value of the currency. This is when we have the floating currency regime, right, which is what Australia has now. So after talking about the different types of monetary systems, we then talk about these special cases being the euro. And finally, we talk about the different issues with currencies in the past, right? Okay, so I'll try not to rush through the lecture. If we don't finish today, we'll continue next week, okay? So how do we define an international monetary system, right? So how do we, what is the objective of a monetary system? So as we mentioned before, the purpose of an international monetary system is to facilitate trades across borders. If I want to trade with my neighbor, I need to be able to determine the value of their currency relative to my currency, right? The questions that we need to ask ourselves are also what do we use to exchange, right? So do I pay them using gold, silver, or any other precious metal, or do I use my banknotes, right? So what do they accept? Also, this is very important. So in terms of currency valuation, most of the time we are talking about relative value, right? So we talk about the value of the foreign currency in terms of my own currency, okay? So I value a different currency based on the value of my currency and vice versa, okay? So the first system that we talk about is the bimetallism system. So this is when we have two different metals in the system that we use as currency, right? So before 1875, we used to exchange goods and services across border using both gold and silver, okay? So we might issue a $2 coin using gold and we issue a $1 coin using silver, okay? So in this case, if every country used gold and silver as their medium of exchange, it's very easy to work out the value of the different currencies across the border, right? So if one Australian dollar is equal to one gold coin and two US dollars is equal to one gold coin, then I can work out the relative prices between the USD and the Australian dollars, right? Okay. So as we mentioned before, we would then work out the value of the currencies based on how much they are worth in terms of gold and silver, Okay. So the system worked for a while, but eventually it collapsed because of this problem over here. So this problem is called the Russian law. So what it says here is that when you have two different metals in your system, eventually one current, one metal would drive out the other one, right? So what does it mean here? It means that the less valuable metal will be the one that tend to be circulated, yeah? So why is that the case? Now suppose that we have two different types of metals, right? We have gold and silver. Suppose that we peg the value of silver and gold using this ratio over here. So a $20 note is made of gold and a $5 note is made of silver, right? So using this ratio over here, can we work out the relative value of gold and silver? So if gold is equal to $20 and silver is equal to $5, that means the value of gold is four times more expensive than the value of the silver, right? Now, suppose gold suddenly become much more valuable than silver, meaning that the actual value of gold is actually more than four times of the silver. What do we think would happen in the market? So suppose that the market is currently trading one gold for four silver, but actually you know that gold is worth more than four silver. One gold is worth more than four silver, right? In that case, if you have a choice of trading one metal versus the other, which metal would you choose to keep and which metal would you choose to trade? Yeah? So do I want to keep the gold or do I want to keep the silver? You want to keep the gold, right? Spot on. So if the gold is more valuable, then why don't I just keep the gold and I give people the silver, right? So if that's the case, eventually, if everyone does the same thing, what would happen to the gold and what would happen to the silver?
Silver will run out of it.
No, silver will run in the system.
Yeah, I know, but silver, the metal itself, is something you can make or produce?
You can...
Is it a resource?
Yeah, it's a resource. I mean, we're just talking about...
Everyone hoards their gold. Everyone starts using silver.
Yeah, yeah.
So obviously silver will be recirculating.
Yeah, so
silver... Why not? Because with copper, you don't get graph coins. Silver is a natural resource. Everyone's using silver.
So any kind of metal can run out eventually, right? You can't mine the earth forever. But what we mean here is if you keep the gold, right, everyone keep the gold, so the gold eventually will go out of the system. Nobody exchange using gold anymore, right? Everyone will be using the silver coins.
Would they have to?
Well, in this example, right, you always have a choice between silver and gold. You will never run out of, well, theoretically, I mean, hypothetically, you never run out of either gold or silver. It's just about the choice of which one you would use, right? So let's keep things simple like that. So assuming that gold and silver never runs out, right? And if you have a choice of keeping either gold or silver and trading the other one, which one would you choose, right? So if I know that gold is much more valuable, I will keep it for myself and I would trade with other people using silver, right? Which means eventually if everyone does the same thing, nobody will be using gold as the medium of exchange anymore. Everyone will be using silver, right? Therefore, eventually, by discretion law, you will not have bimetallism for very long, right? Because eventually people will just use one metal in favor of the other. So this is exactly what happened during that time in the 1875s. So what happened then was people discover gold mines, right? So people did discover a lot of gold mines in the US, I think. And suddenly the value of gold became much less relative to before. So now people use gold as the medium of exchange instead of silver. And eventually, only gold was circulating in the system, okay? So because of that problem, people introduced the gold standard. So the question here is, if people are only trading gold with each other, so why don't we just use gold and we forget about the silver, right? So that was the birth of the classical gold standard in 1875. So during this period, people packed their currency against the gold, right? So for example, if one Australian dollar is worth two gold coins and one US dollar is worth one gold coin, then the value of my Australian dollar versus the US is one Australian dollar is equal to two US dollars, right? So during this period, there was a two-way convertibility between gold and national currencies at a stable ratio, which means that if I peg my Australian dollars against the gold at the ratio of 1 to 2, that means one Australian dollar is two gold coins, then I can exchange the Australian dollar with gold coins at any time I want, right? I can go to the central bank and pay them one Australian dollar to get two gold coins, okay? And vice versa. Also, during this period, I could import and export gold across the border freely, right? Okay. So the exchange rate in this case is basically just the relative value of the currency against the gold, right? So, for example, as we mentioned before, so if $30 US dollars is equal to 1 ounce of gold, and if 6 pounds is equal to 1 pound of gold, I can use this ratio to work out the relative value between the dollar and the pound, right? So it's very important to note that with the classical gold standard, the value of your currency is basically just a function of the gold reserve that you have in your central bank, right? And also, people fix their currency value against the gold using a certain ratio, right? A fixed ratio. For example, in this case, 1 ounce of gold is equal to 30 US dollars, okay? And they tend to keep this ratio fixed, okay? So with the classical gold standards, the exchange rates were very stable because you can easily work out the value of your currency based on how much gold you have in your system, right? Also, any misalignment of exchange rates could be corrected by the price PC flow mechanism, meaning that any time when you say, for example, if you export too much into a foreign currency, so if you're a net exporter, that means people pay you a bit more relative to how much you pay other people. So if you have a positive net export, that means you have a positive net gold flow into the country as well. If that's the case, it makes your currency more expensive relative to the neighbor's currency. And because your currency now becomes more expensive, it discourages exports, right? So your goods become more expensive, people buy your goods a little bit less, okay? If that's the case, it will reduce your net export, and at the same time, it increases back your currency value, okay? So under the classical gold standard, because you basically fix your currency value against the value of the gold that you have, any imbalances in the international trade would be corrected by the price BC flow mechanism, right? Which means any account deficit or account surplus will not last very long, okay? These are what we talk about next week, okay? Now, the problem with this is that if you fix your currency value against the gold, and every time when you export a little bit more, your currency becomes more expensive. It kind of limits the amount of export that you can do, right? So you can't just keep exporting forever, okay? So this problem became very, very severe when the war broke out. So the World War I was in 1915. So during the wartime, countries were trying to finance their weapons and things like that by producing goods and services, right? But because of the price BC flow mechanism, they could not export forever, okay? So they could not increase their exporting as much as they want. As a result of that, people started to predatorily depreciate their currency, meaning that they disregard the rules. They start to depreciate their currency against the gold flow, okay? To try to make their currency a little bit cheaper to increase exports, okay? Okay, let's go through the next slide. So, when countries were desperate to increase their export to produce more, to get more money to finance the war, the classic gold standard started to collapse because people disrespected the fixed currency to gold ratio. Okay. Also, during the wartime, one of the conditions for the classical gold standard was that you need to be able to export and import gold freely between countries, right? So during the war, it was hard to do because people started to close the borders, so on and so forth. So it wasn't very easy to export and import gold, right? As a result, the classical gold standard collapsed. So the main problem with the gold standard was that, number one, you need to fix your currency value against the gold. And number two, you need to be able to import and export gold every time when you have a trade imbalance, right? So you need to be able to adjust your gold reserves accordingly. Now, it's very costly to do because the shipping cost of gold is a little bit too much, okay? Also, the problem was that when you try to grow, when you try to export more, you are limited by the amount of gold that you have in your reserve, right? So what do you think the solution was? So after the war, the developed countries, they came together and they came up with a solution for the classical gold standard, right? Now, as we mentioned before, at the start of the war, the classical gold standard started to collapse. And one of the reasons was that the gold reserves were too limiting, right? So you have to have enough gold for you to be able to grow, which is a bit hard given that gold is limited. So what people came up with was that they say, okay, so besides gold as a reserve, how about we use another currency as an additional reserve, right? So in this case, if I want to grow, instead of holding gold, I can also hold a strong currency as my reserve, right? So at that time, after the war, the US emerged as a very strong economy, and therefore the USD was used as the base currency for the gold exchange system, right, which is the system after the classical gold standard. So in this system, instead of calculating the value of my currency against the gold reserve that I have in my central bank, what I do here is I will calculate the value of my currency relative to the USD, right? At the same time, I will fix the value of the USD against the gold. So when the system was introduced, the value of the USD was $35 per ounce of gold. And for every other currency, its value is depending on the USD reserve, right? So in this case, it helps the other countries in the sense that if they want to grow, they can increase their gold reserve, they can increase their USD reserve instead of increasing the gold reserve, right? Also, if I want to trade across the countries, instead of having to exchange gold, I can exchange just a dollar note, right, which is the USD, which is much cheaper to do. Okay. Now, what do we think is the problem of the system? So I'll tell you the answer. So every time when you see a fixed ratio, it potentially will cause the system to collapse later on, right? Why is that the case? It's because an economy doesn't stay fixed, right? So you grow or you downsize, so on and so forth. So the value of the USD will fluctuate over time. It's unrealistic to expect that the value of the USD is always the same as when you fix the system, right? Also, a second problem is, now, if people want to hold the US dollars, that means other countries have to buy USD, right? So this is what we'll talk about next week, but when you have an outflow of USD out of the system, that means the US will run a trade deficit, right? So when you have a positive outflow outside, that means you pay people money. So if you are a net payer, that means you are a net buyer as well in terms of goods and services, okay? If I pay people money, that means I'm buying something from them, okay? So if I am a net buyer of goods and services, my account would be in deficit. My trade account would be in deficit, okay? So we'll talk about the balance of payments next week, but basically that is what it means, right? So without talking too much about the balance of payments, now, if I have a trade account deficit, that means I buy a lot of things from other people. If I keep doing that, what do you think about my financial wealth? If I keep buying things on credit card over time, what do we think about the financial wealth? So the more I buy, right, the more I consume, the more indebted I will become, right? So as a nation, for the US to be able to maintain this gold exchange system, it has to be in deficit forever, okay? And the more it is in deficit, the more it is indebted to other countries, okay? The problem here is that even though the US was able to persist in decades with their account deficits, but eventually it will erode investor confidence in the US dollars, right? So if I think that the US is having a lot of debt, maybe I don't want to invest in the USD anymore, okay? So the problem here is, for the system to hold, you need other countries to have confidence in the value of the USD. But if the system is to hold, the USD should be depreciated, right? So it's sort of like a catch-22 problem. Okay. So eventually this system was not able to sustain because of the problem that we discussed before with the US deficit. Eventually after 1973, people decided to float the exchange rate, right? So the question here is, instead of fixing my currency against another currency, what about I let the market decide the value of my currency, right? So what about I let supply and demand decide how much my currency is worth, okay? So at the start of this system, central banks were still intervening in the sense that if the exchange rate moved too much, then the central banks will step in to stabilize the exchange rates, right? Under the flexible exchange rate system, because we don't fix our currency value to anything, we don't need to worry about gold as a reserve asset anymore. So is the USD, right? So if we are a really freely floating exchange rate system, we don't have to worry about how much gold we have or how much USD we have in our reserve, okay? So most of the time, countries would, the exchange rate regimes would be in a spectrum. So you might have a country that is 100% floating, like the USD or Australia, or we could have a flexible exchange rate regime in the sense that the government might intervene from time to time, but it will largely let the market decide the value of your currency. On the other hand of the spectrum, you might have a exchange rate regime where it's fully controlled by the central bank, right? Okay. So as we mentioned before, so after 1973, after the gold exchange system, some countries decided to just free float their currency in the sense that the market supply and demand will determine the value of the currency, okay? So in this sense, the central bank is free to do whatever else they want. For example, they want to cut interest rates, they can go on and do that without worrying about the value of their currency, right? You might have something in between, so you might have a managed flow, meaning that you let the market determine the value of your currency, but sometimes you will intervene if the currency value goes too much out of whack, right? You might decide to peg your currency to another currency. This is what a lot of the Latin American countries do. So they peg their currency to the USD, for example. So, for example, in Argentina, they peg their currency, their peso, to the USD, right? You might not have any national currency at all. So this is the situation with the Euro countries, right? You have a common currency across the different zones. Some other countries decide to use another country's currency as their own currency. For example, these countries use the dollar in their system, the US dollar in their system, without having their own currency, right? So we'll talk about this slide later on. Let's go to the next one. Okay, so in terms of determining what kind of monetary system you want to follow, so these are the things that we need to be worried about. So with the different currency exchange regimes, we have something called the impossible trinities, right? Which means that there are three different important objectives of a financial system, being monetary independence. So you use your own currency, you have your own monetary policies. Exchange rate stability is the second goal. This means that your exchange rate doesn't move too much. Why is this important? Now, if we want to trade with a trade partner, right, the more volatile their currency is, the more reluctant we are to trade with them, right, because we have to be exposed to more risk. The final objective is full financial integration, meaning that you invite investors to trade your currency as a financial asset, right? So these are the three main objectives for a monetary system. But in reality, you can never achieve all of the three at once, right? If you want something, you need to give up some other things, right? For example, if we talk about the EU, the European Union, which has a common currency. So with a common currency, we have full financial integration in the sense that all countries within the union will trade using the same currency, right? We also have exchange rate stability, so no worries about foreign exchange rate risk. But at the same time, we need to forego monetary independence, okay? Which is the case of Greece in 2010, right? So they don't have any monetary policy to intervene in their economy when it ran into trouble, okay? With a pure float, with a free floating currency exchange regime, which is what Australia has, we have full financial integration in the sense that people from over the world can trade our currencies without any restrictions, so free capital flows. We have monetary independence in the sense that we have our own currency, we have our own monetary policy, right? But at the same time, we don't have exchange rate stability because we cannot intervene whenever the exchange rate becomes volatile, right? We let the market forces do its thing. Finally, for full capital control, so this is something like when you peg your currency against the US using a fixed ratio. So when you decide to control the value of your currency, the value of the exchange rates, you have monetary independence. You can sell or buy foreign reserves to adjust your exchange rate. You have exchange rate stability because you basically can target a certain rate. But you don't have full financial integration, right? So you don't let the market forces to take its effect. Okay. So depending on what you think is important for your country, you might choose the relevant exchange rate regime, right? So for example, with China, right? China controls their exchange rates. Why do you think that's the case? So for the past couple of years, right, China was a developing country and their main objective was to export, right, to increase their export. So if you want to focus on exporting to other countries, maybe you want a cheap currency, right? Maybe you want to target a very cheap currency so that people buy your goods and services, okay? Also, you want a stable exchange rate so that people want to deal with you, okay? With Australia, we have a pure float currency regime because we are a free financial market, right? So we let the market forces do its thing. Okay, going back. How much time do I have? 10 minutes? Okay, so we talk a lot about different types of exchange rate regimes and we talk about the different objectives that are achieved by a certain type of financial system. So to sum up, if we think about having either a fixed or a flexible exchange rate regime, what are the different considerations that we think about, right? So for a flexible exchange rates, we might want to have a flexible exchange rate regime because it's easier to adjust. This is external adjustment in the sense that demand and supply will do its job and we don't need to intervene at all as a central bank, right? So our job here is very easy. At the same time, because we let the market forces determine the value of our currency, we are not tied up with having to buy or sell foreign reserves, right? So in this sense, we can use our monetary policy for other things. For example, to cut interest rates, to spend on some other things to boost the economy, right? If we have to fix the exchange rates, it might take away some of the power for us to boost the economy, okay? Arguments against flexible exchange rate regimes. So like we saw with the graph before, right, with a flexible exchange rate regime, we don't have a very stable exchange rate because the market sometimes can crash or it can go up without us having to intervene. No safeguards to prevent crisis. So this is not exactly the case. Well, it's true in the sense that we don't, because we can't buy or sell foreign reserves, so we don't have any minimum level we can fall back on. But in the past, some of the currency crisis was caused precisely because they have a fixed exchange rate regime, right? Because they could not let the exchange rate adjust to its real value. Okay, so to illustrate how a currency value might be adjusted under a fixed or a floating exchange rate regime, let's look at this example over here. So suppose that the exchange rate is currently 1.2 US dollar per pound. And the US is currently having a trade deficit, right, which is what we'll talk about next week. But in a nutshell, what it means is that currently the exchange rate is here. And if we look at the graph of supply and demand, obviously it's not in equilibrium, right? So the currency is misvalued in this case. So under a fixed, under a floating exchange rate adjustment, exchange rate regime or a flexible exchange rate regime, what do you think would happen to the currency? If we just let the market forces determine the value of the exchange rates, then we will see this adjustment, right? So currently the market is not in equilibrium. If the market forces are allowed to take its to take effect, then the currency will move back to equilibrium, right, by market forces. So the value of the currency would go up, the value of the pound would go up to equilibrium, okay? So for this week, we'll talk about the European Union and the euro. So as we mentioned before, this is one of the major developments in international monetary system in the sense that it created a very important currency called the euro, right? So the euro was created in 1999 after a few countries in the Europe came together and they decided that they want to have like a monetary system in common between the member countries, yeah? So the member countries within the Euro Union decided to abandon their own currencies and they would trade one common currency called the Euro, right? So if you belong to the European Union, then you can trade with the other members of the Union using the Euro, okay? So effectively this reduces the transaction cost for member countries in the sense that you don't have to convert your currencies to your neighbor country's currency if you're part of the union. Okay, so there's no transaction cost in that sense. There is no exchange rate uncertainty as well within the union because basically you don't have any other currency, right? You're trading just the one currency that you have. Price transparency. So once again, because we are trading using just one common currency, there is no confusion about the denomination currency, right? So if something is priced at 10 euros, that's 10 euros in Germany, it's 10 euros in France as well, okay? Also, because we use one single currency, it actually promotes price-based competition, right? So what do we mean by that? So it means that countries within the union, they will now have to work hard on making their production more efficient so that they can reduce the price of their products, right, to make it more attractive to consumers within the union. So this only works if you have one common currency, right? If you have, say, if Australia and New Zealand, for example, we have two different currencies. So one way that we could be more competitive to New Zealand is instead of focusing on improving the efficiency of our products, we might depreciate our currency, right, to make our goods and services cheaper. So in that sense, we are not any more efficient than before. Our goods and services are only cheaper because we depreciate our currency, right? So that's not exactly very good for consumers on both sides because it's a little bit predatory, right? In contrast, within the European Union, because all countries use the same currency, it basically demolishes that tendency, right? So no single country within the Union would be able to depreciate their currency to fund run other countries, okay? So that promotes price-based competition in that sense, and that increases efficiency, yeah? So the background of the development of the euro currency was that before the euro currency, before the European Union, European countries had to compete with who, right? So they have to compete with the US on the other side of the globe. They've got to compete with Russia as well. And they've got to compete with the emerging economies like China or India, right? So this gives, and therefore it makes sense for them to form a union so that collectively they could be stronger relative to their competitors across the world, right? So at that time, because of the situation they were in, so it was, it makes a lot of sense for them to form the union and introduce a common currency so that they could compete across different other markets, okay? So besides the benefits of the euro as a common currency for member countries, as we mentioned last week, because all the countries give up their own currency and they adopt a common single currency between them, so they therefore lose the power to intervene in the market when their economy is not doing very well, right? So when you give up your own money, that means you give up the right to print money, right? So when the economy is not doing so well, you cannot print money to further boost the economy, right? Another issue was that if you are a member of the Euro Union, you have to follow a certain set of rules and conditions. Right, so you cannot, for example, you cannot have more debt than, say, 20%, right? This is something I make up, but so there are certain rules and standards that member countries have to follow, and that is further restricting for their own policies, right? So an example of a weakness of the Euro Union was what happened in Greece in 2010. So what happened was in 2010, Greece experienced an economic downturn, right? So their GDP dropped from 10% to 3%. So normally for a normal country like Australia, if we have the luxury of pumping money into the system to stabilize the economy, then the crisis might have stopped at that time, right? But because Greece was part of the European Union, they could not issue money, okay? They had to use the euro, right? Because of that, they could not intervene in their own economy, so the problem just got worse and worse, right? In addition to that, because they were part of the EU, when the economy went down, it actually brought down the other economies as well. So people started to panic and they sell off their assets within the European Union, right? So yes, with the euro currency, it makes it easier to trade between the countries, between the member countries. But at the same time, this is what we call a coordination problem, right? So you have to make sure that the countries within the European Union to adhere to the same rules and to be okay, right? So all of them need to be okay for the union to be okay. Otherwise, contagion risk would be very high, right? So the final issue that we talk about in this topic is currency crisis, right? An example here is the Asian crisis in 1997. So what happened in 1997 was At this time, a lot of Asian countries were developing, meaning that they just started to increase their economic wealth, right? So at this time, a lot of Asian countries were still very poor. So in 1997, a lot of Asian currencies were still fixed, right? So they were fixed either to the USD or to some other denomination currencies. And before this period, before 1997, these countries started to open up to foreign investors. Yeah, so they started to open the doors for foreign investments, and because this represented a new investment opportunity, people started to pump too much money into the system. Yeah, so there was a hype up in terms of the Asian assets. Okay, so there was too much money going into these Asian countries. And similar to what happened before the financial crisis 2008, when people get excited about something, they started to be very risky, right? So they started to take risks without understanding what the risks are about, okay? So with the Asian currency crisis in 1997, the main problem was that because, number one, people were being very risky, and number two, because the currencies were basically fixed, so people did not really worry too much about foreign exchange rate risk, right? So they did not think that the currency will be devaluated anytime soon. So you can only hide a bad problem for so long, right? So after a few companies in Thailand started to default, people started to realize that they actually took a lot of risk that they did not understand, right? And at this time, when the problem started to get very big, the Asian countries started to devalue their currency to try to stabilize the economy, right? So this is when the currency were quite fixed, and this is when the problems could not be contained within any single economy anymore, and the government started to devalue their currencies, right? So when the government started to devalue the currencies, foreign investors saw their foreign assets going down in value further, right? And that triggered a panic, and they started to sell off at their asset in a fire sale, okay? So because the Asian economies were quite related, so the problem that happened that started in Thailand started to spread around the other Asian countries, right? And eventually it reached even the richer Asian countries like Korea or Japan, okay? So the key problem here was from a monetary systems point of view. The key problem here is that when we fix a currency value, we basically allow a problem to accumulate for a very long time, right? So had the currency been floated, then the problem might not be that severe, yeah? So when the problem started to happen, the currencies would depreciate, and investors would realize the problem a little bit sooner, right? So the implication here is it highlights the problems with a fixed exchange rate regime, in the sense that you can only fix your exchange rate for too long, right? Okay, so this is what we talked about before. So when we have a large inflow of money into Asian countries, people started to be very risky, yeah? So money is cheap, it's easy for me to make investments, so I just invest in anything. Fixed exchange rates encourage unhedged transactions, so people did not worry about exchange rate risk at all, therefore they left their exchange rate exposure open, okay? Okay. So from the different crises, from the different currency crises in the past, and from the development of the significant currencies like the euro, or from the way that big countries determine their currency values, this is the lesson that we learn. So in terms of the objectives that each of the monetary system tries to achieve, there are three main objectives. The first one being monetary independence. So you have the power within your economy to step in anytime that the economy is not doing too well. As a central bank, I would also like to promote some stability in my exchange rate. Why is that important? This is because I want to encourage investors to invest in my country, right? If my exchange rate is too volatile, it's similar to any risky assets, people would require a higher risk premium to invest in my country, okay? Full financial integration. So this is when I allow the full participation of demand and supply in the market, right? So I let investors determine the value of my exchange rate, okay? So this theory, the impossible trinity, this one says that for a central bank, they can only achieve two goals at one time, right? They cannot achieve all of the three objectives at one time. So for example, for the European Union, so when you have a monetary union, meaning people trade, people use the same currency within different countries, you have exchange rate stability. So people understand how much price that they are trading at because they use the same currency. You have full financial integration. So you let other people trade the euro, right? So it's just like another exchange, right? Another currency. But at the same time, you need to forego your monetary independence, okay? So you don't have any power to issue money in this case. It's determined at the union level. Alternatively, if you choose full capital controls, like what China does at the moment, so they basically fix, they target their exchange rate value, right? So in this case, you have a very stable exchange rate because you have a target and you stick to that target. You have monetary independence, but you don't let investors participate, right? So you don't let investors determine the price of your currency. With a pure float system, this is when you let demand and supply determine your currency value. So you got full financial integration, you still retain monetary independence, so your central bank still has power. But because the exchange rate is determined by the market, you have no way to control it, right? So you don't know where it goes. It depends on how people think about your currency, right?